For the fifth mini lecture, we're going to be focusing on portal hypertension. So, this is a somewhat complex pathophysiology, and we'll try to quickly breeze through that and kind of show an example of how we treat it. So, we'll start with another screen grab that I got off of YouTube. This was done, but from this was taken from Dr. Banu Prakash animated medical videos. You can check it out if you'd like. But it was just a good kind of reminder of what portal hypertension is. So, your portal systems, all your splanchnic veins coming back and gets filtered through the liver. Portal hypertension's caused usually by hepatic cirrhosis. So cirrhosis causes hardening of the liver and fibrosis, and that process makes it difficult for blood flow to get through the hepatic capillaries. And when there's an obstruction within the tissue bed, then the pressure behind the system goes up. So once pressure meets a certain level, then blood starts to cross the venous wall barrier and become ascites. And also, blood's trying to find a way back to the heart through, alternative vascular bloods, and that's how you get your esophageal varices, your gastric and splenic varices, and also spontaneous splenorenal shunts. So that's a spontaneous shunt that allows for blood flow to kind of go against the normal direction of flow from the stomach or spleen into the kidney and the systemic circulation. So as this graphic shows, that anything over 6 millimeters mercury is considered portal hypertension, starts to become clinically significant when it's over 10, and then once it gets over 12, we're starting to see some complications. So again, the most frequent complications we see with portal hypertension would be ascites, varices, and splenomegaly. And something also that you usually see would be portal vein dilation. So, the most common procedure we're asked to help treat portal hypertension with would be a TIPS, which stands for transjugular intrahepatic portal systemic shunt. The reason we get referrals for TIPS are for people who have refractory ascites, so the GI docs have been treating them medically and trying to, give them dietary restrictions, and no matter what they do, they're still requiring frequent large volume paracentesis. Or for people who have had variceal bleeding to decrease the chance of recurrence. And then the most the most challenging TIPS that we get asked to do would be the emergent TIPS for active hemorrhage, so a critical life-threatening event. So some contraindications for for TIPS would be refractory hepatic encephalopathy, so people who have altered mental status due to ammonia levels. TIPS is going to make that worse. TIPS basically is a bypass through the liver to increase blood flow to the heart, and so some of that blood's not going to get cleaned, so your ammonia levels will go up even further. Obviously, if you have a coagulopathy, we're making multiple passes, multiple needle pokes through your liver. That's not going to do well. And then if you have elevated right heart pressures, right heart failure, we're increasing the flow back to the heart, and if your heart can't handle that, we're going to send you into cardiac failure even quicker. I didn't put it down here, but also people with poor liver function, we're changing some of the blood flow dynamics. Livers are primarily perfused by the portal veins, so if we decrease that perfusion, there's a chance that we can send people into acute hepatic failure, which is obviously not what we want either. So very important to review some pre-procedural imaging so we can figure out what we're aiming for. Always good to see people in clinics to guide expectations and kind of give them what the day of procedure is going to be like, what recovery is going to be like, This is a procedure that people need to have general anesthesia and at least one night and usually multiple nights in the hospital post-procedurally, and it may not completely fix the issue that they're getting the tips for. So if they had refractory ascites needing paracentesis, they may still need paracentesis, but hopefully far less frequently and hopefully much less volume, but it's still possible. And then I'm just going to briefly touch on BRTO. It's kind of the cousin slash brother to the tips. So it stands for balloon occluded retrograde transvenous obliteration, which is a mouthful. It's somewhat for treating left-sided portal hypertension, quote unquote. Basically, it makes gastric varices and hepatic encephalopathy better. So in the sense of hepatic encephalopathy, it's kind of opposite of the tips, but also opposite of the tips, it has the opportunity to make ascites and esophageal varices worse. So I'll show you during this case. So this is a patient who has multiple reasons to need a tips. So as you can see, she's got lots and lots of ascites. That's what this dark stuff is. This is fluid around the liver and around the bowel loops and spleen and everything else. And also she has lots of these abnormal tortuous enhancing vessels. These are varices, probably gastric varices here. So this is a axial image of the same patient. So again, lots of ascites, big vessels. And our goal of our tips is to make a connection between the right hepatic vein, which would be about right here, and connect it to our right portal vein, which is right here. And in this case, her portal vein is pretty small, and that's because she has all these gastric varices and this. And this is our spontaneous gastrorenal shunt. So instead of a lot of the blood going to the liver this way, it is bypassing the liver and going into the inferior vena cava. So the goal of a BRTO is to get a catheter into this position, block the outflow because blood is coming this way towards the systemic component, and then put some medicine into these gastric veins to irritate them and cause them to scar down. So in this case, we were starting with performing our tips. So this image is tough to see, but I'm going to annotate it for you. So we got a catheter into the right hepatic vein and then injected some CO2 gas. So that is our form of contrast. And because it's so low viscosity, when you inject it, it can go back through the capillaries and sinusoids into the portal system, and it gives us a target to aim for. So this is our right hepatic vein, and this is our right portal vein, and the whole goal of doing a TIPS is to create this bypass, this shunt, through the liver parenchyma from the right hepatic vein to the right portal vein, so a porto to systemic shunt, like the name. And that's exactly what we did. So we used this big needle set and this cannula to get transhepatic access and do an actual contrast injection into the portal vein to prove that we're there. Then you get a wire into the portal system, the superior mesenteric vein. We're doing a little angioplasty or plasty of the liver parenchymal tract so that we can get our sheath down here. So eventually we can place the actual stent that'll serve as the shunt. In the meantime, we do a portal venogram, which shows all these big varices that we are going to deal with. And it also shows we're using this marking pigtail so we can decide how long of a stent we need to put in place. And then we move on to our BRTO component of this, because the patient needed both, remember. Eventually, we get access into that spontaneous shunt and then occlude it. You can use a balloon like the name says, but most people don't do that anymore. You can use coils, but it would take a lot of coils, or you can use a plug, which in this case, that's what we did. So we've plugged the outflow, and we already had access from the inflow side, and we, you know, put some coils as embolization, and then also got a small catheter beyond our coils and injected some of this sclerosing medicine to scar down those gastric varices. And in the end, this is our final image. So now we have this TIPS stent, which is in place and opacifying, which is good. And we have our occlusion material in our gastric varices. Hopefully, just by decreasing the pressure, some of the esophageal varices will go away and improve the ascites. And that's exactly what happened. So this was a really good outcome for a pretty complicated case.